dipping, he begged me to stay. Bae, I'm not staying, I just wanna play. In the party, he just wanna rump. Big boobs in the bus, they plump. She a baddie, she knows she a 10. She a baddie with her baddie friend.
Hi guys, welcome back to Mam Sihle's class for life science. And today, we're gonna be looking at biodiversity and classification for grade 10. So let's get into it. So the focus for today is biodiversity and classification. So now the word biodiversity is made up of two words. It is made up of bio and it's also made up of diversity. Now when you look at bio, bio means life. Bio means life. And now when we look at diversity, we are now looking at variety, or we're looking at what? Variation. Great. Now, what is biodiversity then? What is the definition of biodiversity? So, biodiversity then means or refers to the variation of life forms on Earth that are found on Earth. There's different kinds of life forms that are found on Earth. The most simplest being what? Your plants, as well as being your animals. These are different kinds of life forms that are found on Earth, but we have a tons of variety of them. Now, when we look at the other term, which is classification, we are now looking at arranging items according to their similarities. However, we are now talking about biodiversity, and we said that biodiversity refers to the variation of life forms that are found on Earth. So we are classifying these very life forms. So we can't be talking about items, rather we are now talking about what? Arranging life forms, arranging organisms. Do you understand? So you are now arranging what? You are arranging your life forms. You are arranging what? You are arranging your organisms. That's what we're talking about. We are classifying organisms. We are classifying different life forms according to their similarities. Great. Now, we now look at something that is done in the science world. So the science that is behind this classification is referred to as taxonomy. Now, what is taxonomy? So taxonomy is the science of naming, describing and classifying organisms. So since we've got our definitions, we have looked at biodiversity, we've looked at classification, and now we just looked at taxonomy. So let us go through our biological terms once more again. As we know that in life science, our biological terms are very, very important. So let us go through our biological terms one more time. We said that biodiversity is the variation of life forms on Earth. We have different kinds of life forms, and that variation is called biodiversity. Bio meaning life, diversity meaning variation. Now, classification. We are now arranging these life forms according to their similarities. We are able to classify them to certain categories that these are humans, these are dogs because of their similarities. Then we have taxonomy. Now, when we look at taxonomy, we're now looking at the science of doing all of that. We're looking at the science of naming, the science of describing, and the science of classifying these organisms. Great stuff. Now, let us get into the real thing. Classification can be a bit tricky because problems would arise when a certain species would fit into more than one category. But fortunately for you, a new common and modern system has been introduced, and that is the Five Kingdom system of classification. Now, under the Five Kingdom classification, we have five kingdoms. Now, under your kingdom Animalia, this is where you most likely find your elephants, your whales,
number two,
your snakes, your snails, and of course as well as humans. And then you have your kingdom Plantae. Your kingdom Plantae, this is where you'll find your trees, you're gonna find your flowers, and if you're like me, for Valentine's you would have loved to get some tulips, but you find your roses and all kinds of flowers under kingdom Plantae. Then we have your kingdom Fungi. Your kingdom Fungi, this is where you will find your fungus, things like your mushrooms. And then lastly, we will find our kingdom Monera. This is where we're gonna find our bacteria. We're gonna find different kinds of bacteria. We're gonna find rods, we're gonna find cocci, we're gonna find spiral. These actually describing the shapes of the bacteria, as you see here. Now, remember we are talking about classification of organisms. And I said to you, under Kingdom Animalia, you're going to find your humans, you're going to find your elephants, and all kinds of animals. But if you were to put an elephant and me next to each other, we are not really the same species. Yes, we may fall under the same kingdom, but we are not the same species. So what does this tell you? When you look at a kingdom, it is generalizing. It's not really being specific about a group of that species, not being specific about that type of organism. So when we look at a kingdom, when you look at a kingdom, you think of a kingdom as an umbrella. It's an umbrella. And under this umbrella, you're gonna find different categories as you go down. Now, the first category under kingdom, you are going to find your phylum. That's the first category. After phylum, then you're gonna find something called your class. After class, then you're gonna find something called your order. And after your order, you are definitely going to be having your family. After your family, you then get your genus. And after your genus, you will then finally get your species. Now, think of it like this. If someone from Northwest was to come to you, they don't know Gauteng, they don't know any other area but where they're from. So you then say you come from Gauteng. Gauteng, you're generalizing. There's so many other areas of Gauteng. So for you to be more specific, you're gonna continue giving them more details. I come from Gauteng. Where in Gauteng? In Johannesburg. So as you go down, you're being more specific. That applies as well to our classification here. From kingdom, I'm being general. I'm saying that me and elephants fall under the same kingdom. But are we really the same? No, we may share similarities, but are we really the same type of organism? No. So I need to be specific. I stay in Gauteng. Where in Gauteng? I'm from Johannesburg. Johannesburg has so many suburbs to them. I'm from Soweto. I'm now becoming more and more specific. And as I'm being more specific, the pool of ideas or guesses of where I may come from becomes less for the person. It doesn't become too much for them to think about. I'm from Gauteng, where in Gauteng, Johannesburg. Where exactly in Soweto? Now I get into it. There's so many townships in Soweto. There is Pimville, there is Diepkloof, there is Middlelands, there's Zola, Mdeni, Dobsonville, there's so many. So I'm from Gauteng, Johannesburg, Soweto, Middlelands. Middlelands is divided into zones. I'm from zone 7. Then I can give the street name as well as the house number. Then I am done. I have become more specific. Unlike general. So when we are here at the top, when you are here at the kingdom, you are more general. But then as you go down, then you become more specific. Are we together? Cool. Now let's look at us as humans. So when we look at the classification of humans, remember, we said that we fall under the kingdom Animalia. Now, what type of phylum do we fall under? There are about 35 phylums in the world, but only about 9 are actually studied and are well understood by people. But fortunately for you, when you get to grade 11, you're only going to study about six phylums. You're going to study about six phyla. Now, the phyla that we fall under as human beings is called the phylum Chordata. The class that we fall under, it's not upper class, middle class, or lower class, but rather the class that we all fall under is called mammalia. We are mammals. We fall under the class mammalia. So don't worry when someone says, no, you're middle class. No, tell them that we're all under one class, which is called class mammalia. And the order that we come from is primates. We are primates. That's our order. And our family is called hominidae. Hominidae. The genus is Homo. And our species name is sapiens. Great. Now, I know it's probably a lot for you to take in. Phylum, class, order. It's all causing a headache. It's too many words. It's too many terms for you to handle. But obviously, there is an easier way of actually getting to have this in your head, to actually know it without thinking a lot. What we do something called mnemonics. Now, mnemonics are very helpful when you want to remember words. So we're gonna take the first letter of each word here. We have K, P, C, O, F, G, S. And you can make something out of it. For example, King Philip came over for some good soup. I don't know why I said it's twice. But King Philip came over for good soup. Or you can say kids prefer candy over fresh green salad. Or kids prefer candy over fried green spinach. Or you can also say Kwaito people come out from Gauteng singing. There are so many you can create. So it is all up to you and what actually works for you. And that way you know that as I move down, I'm actually becoming specific. The first one is kingdom, Kwaito, king, kids. Phylum, prefer, Philip, people. Class, the sea, come over. Come, candy. Oh, over, out. F, fresh, fried, for, from. G, good, Gauteng, green. S, sing, soup, salad, and spinach. So it is all up to you how you actually wanna be able to make it fun for yourself to be able to remember it. So King Philip came over for good soup. King Philip came okay. King Philip came over for green salad. It is all up to you on how you actually want to make it work. Now, I want to get in onto the last ones. Normally, when we ask what is the scientific name for humans, people will most likely say Homo sapiens. Now, I want to get into that. Homo sapiens. Now, it is made up of a genus as well as a species. Now, when we look at this, we are actually looking at a scientific name for an organism, that organism being a human. And I can give you many other scientific names for other organisms. For example, we have a Musca domestica. Musca domestica is actually a house fly, the most irritating organism that I know. And we also have a disgusting one. We have a periplaneta americana. Now, a periplaneta americana is actually an American cockroach. It's an American cockroach. I'm just gonna write roach. It's an American cockroach, right? So, what is common in all these names? They all compose of a genus, and they also compose of a species, right? Now, think of this as your first name, as well as your last name. Just like me, my name is Sipe Sihle Radebe. But then, if I'm asking for my scientific name, it would be Homo sapiens. Homo is the genus and sapiens is the species that we are. So, how are we, what is this? This is the classification of an organism. When we are looking for the scientific name of an organism, we're gonna put together the genus as well as the species. And this type of writing is called the binomial system. This is referred to as the binomial system. Oh, I wrote binomial. Pardon that. Binomial. Bi means two. And the word nomial comes from, just means names. So it's two names. It's a two-name system. Two-name system. Now, what is very, very important about this binomial system is that when you write it down, you are expected to underline. So the most important thing is that the first name that you're gonna write has an uppercase. It's a big letter. And then the following name doesn't have any big letters, but it's written in lowercase letters. After writing this, you are to underline it. Now, if you're like me and you are a varsity student, instead of actually writing it like this, we are expected to type it in italics. But because you are most likely writing down on paper, you cannot write in italics. So you are expected to always underline a scientific name of an organism. Now, we are all talking about how we have the binomial system, how a scientific name of an organism comprises of two names. But we haven't spoken about the people that came up with these. We haven't spoken about the people that made all of this possible. Now, so we've spoken about classification, taxonomy, and how we're actually able to give the scientific name of a species, giving it the genus as well as the species, right? Now, we need to know who was able to actually give us this opportunity. Now, we speak about a man named Carolus Linnaeus. Carolus Linnaeus. I hope I am not butchering his name, actually. Now, this man was a Swedish botanist and physician. And what he did, he classified plants and animals according to their similarities, right? And then he divided them into two main kingdoms, actually, of living forms, being the plant as well as the animal kingdom. Now, this man also came up with the system that we were using, which is the binomial system. And he said we can give the scientific name of an organism by combining the genus as well as the species. And then together we have the scientific name of an organism. So if you notice something in science, most of the names that we use are actually in Latin. So you're probably asking yourself, why did they use Latin? Why not isiZulu, Sotho, Venda, or Afrikaans, right? So Latin was actually a universal language of science among scholars. So it was a language that they used, and hence till today, when we speak, when we study, we come across these terms, because back then that is how they communicated. That is how it all began. This was a universal language, a universal science language among scholars. And remember, it was Western scholars, so obviously it was spread among them around Europe. Hence we are finding ourselves studying Latin instead of Zulu, Sotho, Venda, Afrikaans, and all these other languages. So we are now done with the first part of biodiversity and classification. This is where we looked at what is biodiversity, what is classification, and then we're able to discover that there is a science of actually naming, describing, as well as classifying organisms, and that is called taxonomy. And that gave us the five kingdom system, of which we said we have kingdom Animalia, kingdom Plantae, kingdom Monera, kingdom Fungi, as well as kingdom Protista. And then we're able to look at the binomial system, of which till today we still use. So we are able to see that an amazing scientist, Mr. Linnaeus, was able to give us a system that is still used. So in the next video, we'll then be focusing on prokaryotes as well as eukaryotes. I hope to see you there. Don't forget to like, comment, subscribe, as well as share the video.
Mwah. No balls.